will face trials. They will face troubles. It's never going to be easy. It's always going to be trials. And these trials are there to guarantee us Jannah. I'm hasiban, you know, Allah Azza wa Jalla says in Surah Al-Ankabut in the very beginning, and by the way, Surah Al-Ankabut is the Surah of Da'wah. If you want to learn the ethics of Da'wah and the most important principles of Da'wah, you go to Surah Al-Ankabut. It's one of the best places to learn about Da'wah in the Quran. In the beginning, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, أَحَسِبَ النَّاسِ أَنْ يُطْرَكُوا أَنْ يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. People assume they're going to just say they believe, they're not going to be tested. People have just assumed they just have to become Muslim and just come to make salah and just go home and that's it. They have iman, they're not going to be tested. وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. We thoroughly tested those who came before them also. These ayat came down when Khabbab bin al-Arq radiallahu anhu paid a price for making da'wah to Islam. Not just accepting Islam, calling people to Islam. The Quraysh, they took this companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they took this companion, they put him on burning coal until his back, the skin on his back melted and was peeled off. And in this horrid state, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, if we are the people of truth, why is this happening to us? How can we deserve this if we are the people of the truth? And Allah, and the Messenger told him, you are rushing. There are people that came before you that were sawed in half, or buried into the ground alive because of la ilaha illallah. So you're rushing to judgment. Don't rush to it. And then the ayat came down. You think you're just going to get Jannah just like that? Imagine what he went through, and Allah said, that's not even that. You haven't really paid yet. We have to be mentally prepared for trials. When we engage in the work of da'wah, we have to be mentally prepared for trials. Now, in this surah, when Allah gave this passage about how to make da'wah and be patient and struggle, then he mentioned a number of prophets. I'm only going to mention the immediate two prophets that are mentioned right after. Immediately after this passage, Allah starts talking about Nuh alayhi salam. And immediately after that, he starts talking about Ibrahim alayhi salam. What's the significance of first talking about da'wah, then talking about Nuh alayhi salam, and then Ibrahim alayhi salam, immediately after that? You see, Nuh alayhi salam, if you know nothing else, you know it's relentless da'wah. It's non-stop da'wah. It is consistent, untiring, unflinching calling to Islam for 950 years continuously. So this, what is this teaching us fundamentally? That this work is not something that can be done over a month or a year or a seminar. It's something that has to be a constant effort of work. This has to be a constant work of the Sunnah. The constancy of Nuh alayhi salam is alluded to. Then Ibrahim alayhi salam, and by the way, if you want to give an adjective to the da'wah of Ibrahim alayhi salam, you would have to say fearless da'wah. Fearless da'wah. So there's constant da'wah, Nuh alayhi salam. And there's fearless da'wah, Ibrahim alayhi salam. And no matter what the consequences, he's not going to let go of la ilaha illallah. He's not going to let go of it. Our da'wah should not be based on fear. Our da'wah should not be based on anger, and it should not be based on fear. It should be neutral, like the da'wah, the calm, collected da'wah of Ibrahim alayhi salam. He has the ability to talk to even one of the worst human beings in nice language. Just in logical discourse, intellectual discourse, he's able to do that alayhi salam. So we have to learn from these things. Now what I wanted to conclude with, inshaAllah ta'ala, is just some basic food for thought that all of us need to take a little more seriously, if we are to engage in this work. If we are really serious about taking the work of da'wah forward in this country at the level of a community and even as individuals. Sometimes, when you think about the problems of the Muslims, those problems are so big that you get overwhelmed. And when you get overwhelmed, you say, oh man, there's no solution. Man, we got so many problems, I don't even know when it's going to stop. Right? That's usually our attitude. Sometimes this becomes a casual, entertaining conversation over dinner. Man, we got so many problems, our rulers are so corrupt, the media hates us, they send that and the other. We make a list of all the problems we have. It's like our, the non-Muslims have Alcoholics Anonymous and their therapy sessions. We have Jai Anonymous, right? We just sit over Jai and we discuss the problems of the Muslims and we don't do nothing about them, right? We say it's too big a problem for us to fix. Now, how do we change that attitude? First of all, Allah Azza wa Jalla does not demand from me or you to change the whole world. What does He demand from us? To change ourselves. That's what He demands from us. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. It is no doubt that Allah is not the one to change what is afflicting a nation until they change what is in their own selves. Right? Not even be Him, be أَنفُسِهِمْ. Within their own selves, at the individual level. What am I doing wrong? How am I misrepresenting Islam in the way I deal with my wife, with my neighbor, with my coworkers, with the people that drive by me on the highway? How am I misrepresenting Islam being a Muslim? You can change that much. Instead of complaining, complain about yourself. Start with that. The second thing I said, you know, the biggest problem was our behavior. So let's start changing our behavior, right? The second problem above that was our ignorance. So we need to address that too. We need to become students of this deen. We need to start asking more and more questions. We need to start to learn more and more and more. We need to connect with people that know better than we do, so we can call them or email them or, you know, visit them and learn from them. It's not necessary that you join a madrasa or you become a muhaddith or a mufti, etc., to represent the basics of Islam. But it is important that you connect it with somebody who has knowledge. If you at least have some contact with somebody who has knowledge, when something comes up, you can ask them, you can learn about it, right? And my advice would be to have someone like that who's actually a living person, not someone behind the screen with a screen name, and you have no idea what you're getting, what knowledge you're getting online, right? It may or may not be valid. So if you have a person like, the imams of our community, subhanAllah, they're a wonderful resource for them. We need to put them to work. We need to be going to them and asking them these sorts of questions. This is our second issue. As for the first concern, you know, this idea of Muslims being portrayed in the West, we need to be a little bit more, a little stronger at the local level. Don't worry about what's happening in the United States, worry about what's happening in your town. We should have, the sisters should have a women's program at the public library, women in Islam, or the veil of the Muslim woman. It was a controversial topic. And invite the Muslim, non-Muslim women of the community and let the Muslim women speak to the non-Muslim women about what this, what they stand for and how much confidence they have. You know, when that girl, you may or may not have heard, that girl who ran away from her house in Columbus, Ohio, she converted to Christianity, and she accused her father of trying to kill her and all of that, which is all a lie. I met the father. That's all a lie. It's bogus. You know, and they weren't even a religious family. She was a cheerleader before she ran away. So what's he gonna, he should have killed her for that, right? If anything, if he's crazy. But he didn't. He didn't say anything. So this is all bogus. That's all bogus. But anyway, you know who the best people are to respond to that? Why these Muslim, what about these Muslim girls that are being oppressed in their homes? The best people to respond are Muslim teenage girls themselves. Why don't they speak, write an article for the local paper, and say, what are you guys talking about? We have it better than anybody else, right? We have to speak up. We have to represent this team. We have to stand up and say, this. You can't say this about us. This is not who we are. And you know, instead of constantly running after all the allegations they make against us and say, no, we're not this. We don't oppress women. We don't hate you. We don't want to kill everyone. We're not strapping any explosives when we go to the mall, etc., etc. Instead of constantly answering their allegations and constantly telling people what Islam is not, we need to start telling people what Islam is. They're constantly making us tell them what Islam is not. But this will not stop until we tell people what Islam is. We need to tell them. And instead of them criticizing us, if you learn something from the da'wah of the prophets, they look at the greatest evils of their society and they criticize those evils. They don't just talk about iman in the akhirah and just the hate. No, they go beyond that too. Lut alayhi salam says, you people are committing shamelessness. He goes after their shameless behavior. Shu'aib alayhi salam goes after the corrupt business practices of his people. If there is a corruption in the society, who's supposed to stand for it? It is the Muslims. So what we need to be recognized as, if we were really doing da'wah, you know how people would see us? People would see us, these people don't care what happens to them, they stand up for justice. Anybody who is oppressed, the Muslims stand up for them. They're not a lobby for their own selves, they are a lobby for the people, for justice, for equal rights. And then whenever there's a violation, somebody's integrity is being questioned, somebody's rights are being usurped, the Muslim stands up. And this is the sunnah of our Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look, I'll leave you with one example just to think about how we need to rethink how we make da'wah in this country. Just to rethink it. You know, there was a, I told you, Khabbab bin Arat. Before this, you know, even when you're little, you heard the story of Yasir radiallahu anhu, right? And his wife. And you know, his child, how they were executed basically for saying La ilaha illallah. When the Messenger saw this happen in front of his own eyes, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he say? Did he have a, was there any sort of a protest? any picket fence, any yelling and screaming, stop the killing of the Muslims, any standing in front of the United Nations and protesting and screaming at him, nothing. What did he say to them? He said, have patience, isbiru ya Yasir, ya Ahl Yasir. O family of Yasir, have sabr. Your place is Jannah. He told them to have sabr. When you are on this path, instead of complaining about the troubles that come to you, you have to have patience. But in the same era, a mushrik, a non-Muslim, came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he told them that Abu Jahl has taken my money, and he won't give it back. He didn't tell him, be patient. He didn't. To the Muslim, he said, be patient. To the non-Muslim, he grabbed him by the hand, took him to Abu Jahl, and said, you better give him his money back. SubhanAllah. So we are putting ourselves in sacrifice for the justice to be served for others, not for ourselves first, for others first. This is why Allah says, "Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat," not minan nas, but lin nas. You are the best of nations derived, not from the people, but for the people. Allah says, you are the best nation chosen, not from the people, but for the people. We are here to serve. What Allah's religion has to offer is a service to humanity. Allah came to remove the shackles of oppression that are oppressing the people around us. Also, our attitude needs to change. We have to become a little more confident. We have to stop being so defensive all the time. This, we're not this and we're not this and we're not that. Let's start learning what we are and sharing what we are with our friends and neighbors. First, and again, I reiterate and I'm done, none of this sharing of Islam will be of any benefit to anyone until we see a change in our behavior. Until we see a change in our attitude. May Allah Azza wa Jalla make us capable of changing our behavior. May Allah Azza wa Jalla make us better Muslims because of this blessed month of Ramadan. May Allah Azza wa Jalla keep us away from the evil things that we have left before this month started and make us abandon them for the rest of our lives. May Allah Azza wa Jalla make us truly capable of tawbah to Him. May Allah make us an ummah that stands up for the message of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. May Allah Azza wa Jalla make us, our children, our families versed, very knowledgeable in the book of Allah and the sunnah of His Messenger, and make them capable with confidence of sharing its message with friends and neighbors alike. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ni wa iyyakum bil ayat wa dhikri. Alhamdulillahi wa kafa wa salatu wa salamu ala ibadihi alladhi nastafa khususan ala afdalihim wa khatam al-Nabiyyin Muhammadin al-Amin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. يقول الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن قل أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد عباد الله رحمكم الله اتقوا الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون أقم الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت